Well, I am going to pick up at verse 31. As a reminder, especially since I wasn't here last Sunday and we had Easter also in there, we have just had the so-called Last Supper, Jesus' Passover Seder with his disciples. He institutes communion at this time. He announces that one of them is going to betray him, and Judas Iscariot eventually leaves the room. And they likewise finish the Seder, they sing a hymn, and now they go out to the Mount of Olives, we are told. The Mount of Olives sits right outside the wall of Jerusalem there, right opposite the temple. And there at the Mount of Olives is a little place, and if you visit Israel, you'll visit this place known as the Garden of Gethsemane. Trees thousands of years old. And so verse 31 tells us that Jesus said to them, "All of you will be made to stumble because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee." Once more, we see Jesus modeling an important truth for us. If God's word says it, you can be assured it will come to pass. And Jesus makes very clear, no doubt at all, that the scripture is going to be fulfilled. He is quoting from Zechariah in the Old Testament and applying that prophecy about striking the shepherd to himself and what's about to take place. But then you'll note he cuts off his quote, and then verse 32 is actually his own words reminding them again, "But I'm going to rise." Whenever Jesus spoke of his crucifixion, when he spoke of his suffering, he also spoke of his resurrection. And it is fascinating that the disciples never did really seem to grasp that, because we certainly don't see them when Jesus is crucified and ultimately dies and is buried. We don't see them with any sort of thought about, well, didn't he say he was going to rise? Maybe they think it's all over. They think it's done. And yet Jesus reminded them, "I'm going to rise, and I'm going to see you again. I'll go before you to Galilee." Well, Peter answered and said to him, "Even if all are made to stumble because of you, I will never be made to stumble." And Jesus said to him, "Well, assuredly I say to you that this night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." And Peter said to him, "Even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples. Matthew, including himself there, of course, being one of the disciples and also writing this gospel, I always think it's always a powerful thought that as he was writing that down, including himself, knowing that Jesus' words are, of course, going to come to pass, and we're going to see the disciples scattered here shortly. But very specifically, Jesus makes a prediction about Peter, and of course, we're going to see this come to pass as well in the couple weeks ahead of us. It's fascinating, and I don't have an explanation, but when we were in the upper room at the Last Supper, and Jesus says, "One of you is going to betray me," one of the points I made is to observe that they all began to ask, "Well, am I going to do it? Am I going to do it?" And recognizing their weakness, but also recognizing that if Jesus says it, it's going to come to pass. One of you is going to betray me, okay? That wasn't even open to debate. Instead, they began to ask, "Well, am I going to be the one to do it?" And I'm sure they said that with heavy hearts, not imagining they could, but... And yet, now we are still the same night, just, you know, a couple hours or whatever later, maybe, and Jesus says something, and they're challenging him on it. "No, well, that'll never happen. We'll never do that." Like I said, I can't explain it, but it's fascinating, isn't it? I also can't explain how we, as children of God, can, in one moment, the very same day, just be filled with the Spirit, be on fire, just absolutely loving the Lord, and then fall on our face a few minutes later, right? I mean, you could just hear, "I'm never going to sin again, man. I mean, this is great, you know, Lord." So, and boom. It can happen, can't it? We're going to look at that a little bit today. Well, they're all challenging him on this. And Jesus isn't going to argue with him. He did make that point to Peter, though, and we're going to see that come to pass. I do believe, though, and especially with Peter, that they're being sincere. You know, I don't think that we can be critical necessarily of the boasting per se, because again, this is where their hearts are. They couldn't imagine denying their Lord. And no doubt they had heard those messages that Jesus had given about, you know, those who deny me, I'll deny before my Father. You know, they probably remembered those lessons. And so they could not dream that they would be guilty of such a thing, given their love and their dedication to their Lord. But Jesus said it, and if Jesus said it, we need to accept it. Verse 36 tells us that Jesus came with them then to a place called Gethsemane and said to the disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray over there." And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee. That would be James and John. They were kind of an inner circle among the disciples, Peter, James, and John. And he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. And then he said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me." That must have been quite an emotional moment. I don't know how visibly Jesus looked, but I'm sure it was evident to Peter, James, and John of this sorrow and distress that he was going through at this moment. And he asked them, again, these were like his closest friends here on earth, to, "Hey, can you guys watch with me? Can you be with me for a little while I go pray?" Now, as Christians, not just this church, but any true Christian church, an absolutely essential, foundational teaching concerning Jesus Christ is to his deity. He is God in human flesh. That, of course, is a view that not only is denied by the secular, non-religious, atheistic world, but, of course, denied by every other religion. Oh, there might be a couple exceptions where, on the one hand, they claim some sort of deity for Jesus, but they also say, "You can have it too, you know, and he's nothing special." So we're not talking about that kind of stuff. The only begotten Son of God, the only one to ever be God here on earth, walk among us. All religions deny it. The unbelieving world denies it. Even those groups, those cultic groups that want to claim some sort of allegiance to Christianity and the Bible, but they really have their own writings and all the rest of it and their own founders and all, they also, one thing they have in common, they may teach different things. Jehovah's Witnesses may teach different from Mormons, who teach different from Christian Scientists and so forth, but where they're united is in their denying of the deity of Jesus Christ. We stand and affirm the deity of Jesus Christ, as, again, does every true Christian church, whatever the denomination. But even though it's right for us to affirm this, and we have to affirm it repeatedly, let us never forget the humanity of Jesus Christ. See, he is fully God and he is fully man. You cut Jesus, he bleeds. He's a human being. And if we have in our mind the idea of, "Well, he's God, you know, this was no big deal for him." He's also a human being, just like any of us. Now, when I say "just like," I should probably qualify that, because obviously we all have a sin nature. Jesus has no sin nature. But let's remember, Adam and Eve had no sin nature either when they were created. Now, they were never God, but they were perfect humanity. Jesus is perfect humanity as well as perfect deity. Not a 50-50 hybrid or something, but fully 100%, 100% in this union, God and man. We are getting a glimpse of that humanity right here. And so, he's sorrowful exceedingly. He knows what is awaiting him right now. It's upon him, and the hours that are going to tick off here are going to be filled with suffering and agony. And so he asks for his friends to watch with him a little bit. And verse 39 tells us, he went a little farther and he fell on his face and he prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Now that truly, when it comes to Scripture, is holy ground right there. And how blessed we are that God included it for us all to learn from. This prayer of Jesus to the Father at this moment there in Gethsemane. And there is a lot here for us to look at. We see, as he says, "Not my will, your will be done." As he asks for the cup to pass from him, the cup is a reference to the suffering he's about to face there at the cross and all that's associated with it. We see in that humanity of Jesus what frankly would be common sense. What person would want to go through such suffering and agony and misery, just in and of itself? However, what we see clearly demonstrated here, and of course it's demonstrated throughout the entire life of Christ, is subjecting himself to the will of the Father at all times. And so he prays, he petitions. Now, I've actually heard guys, when they're trying to teach on prayer, and I say trying to because they're doing a lousy job of it, tell us, you and me, we should never say, you know, "Not my will, your will be done, God," because that shows a lack of faith. Just go out there and claim. That's garbage. And frankly, what I may want for myself, if it's not the will of God, then I don't want it anymore, because I know that God only wants the absolute best for me. And I don't necessarily always know what the best is. I mean, guy needs work, and he's got a job interview and an opportunity, and I really need this job, Lord, and I pray I can get it. But you may have some other plan in mind I don't know about. Nevertheless, not my will, your will be done. I'm going to go out there. I'm going to do my best interview, you know, fill everything out, be right. But I leave it in your hands for the results, Lord. That's how we live. That's how we should live. So don't listen to that nonsense. It's not a lack of faith, because Jesus himself right here is modeling it for us. But I also notice in the prayer, he qualifies by saying, "if it is possible." You know, you take a step back and say, well, if what is possible? What does "it" kind of refer to? And if we meditate on that for a moment, we realize that what Jesus is talking about, if it is possible, is if it's possible for you and me and the world to be saved from our sins in any other way other than the cross. If there's some other way to reconcile the world back to God, and that's how it happens, because God didn't drift anywhere, we're the ones that went astray, to reconcile us back for the holy, righteous, just God to be satisfied that sin has been justly dealt with. Is there some commandments, 10 or some other number, some religious code of ethics, some sort of rules that we could give the people and just say, look, just do this and your sins will be forgiven? Is there anything we can do? Anything possible at all? See, all of that gets lumped into this idea here. And of course, we recognize there is no other way. Once more, common sense ought to tell us, would the Son of God have had to have suffered in such a way if it was possible for us to be saved by rules and law-keeping and religious effort? No, you see, Jesus went to the cross, endured the shame and the suffering because of the joy that waited before him. And that joy was, again, the opportunity that we have to be forgiven. Just like the deity of Christ is a thing that sets Christianity apart from everything else in the world, so is this fact. Every other religion in the world, every other philosophy, every other moral ethic or whatever is all about, you know, you do this, you live a good life, you help people, you give and so forth, you'll be rewarded with heaven someday. It's all about your faithfulness, your works, your efforts. And Christianity is the only thing that absolutely says there is nothing that you and I can do. If there was, Christ wouldn't have had to come and die. No. Christianity says that Jesus did all the work and we simply receive that gift of forgiveness. But Jesus is pouring his heart out before the Father here in this prayer. And having completed it, verse 40 tells us, he then went to the disciples and he found them asleep. And he said to Peter, "What? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Now, watch this, because we were just speaking about in the humanity of Jesus, that desire of the suffering he's going through emotionally, and you see it in the prayer, "Oh Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me." And the idea, I just want my friends to be watching there, to be, you know, to be here on the side, and there they are sleeping, you know, it's the middle of the night. But does Jesus come to him and say, "After all I've done for you, after all these years, here you are sleeping, and I just ask you one little thing. How many times have I ever asked you anything, disciples?" But he doesn't do that. Instead, his care is for them. Oh, the love of Jesus Christ. "Don't be sleeping, Peter." Why? "Because I need you at this time." No, he says, "Because you need to be praying. Because I know your spirit is willing." That goes back to the sincerity of, "I'll never deny you." Jesus knew that was truly the desire of his heart. He couldn't imagine. "But you don't understand how weak your flesh is. And temptation is coming. You need to be watching. You need to be praying. Now is not the time to be sleeping." And certainly if we are sleeping when we should be praying, then we are ripe for a fall. And so you see Jesus' care for them when he asks them about why they're sleeping. It's not selfish at all, is it? It's selfless. Just like every other aspect of Jesus' life. Verse 42 tells us again a second time he went away and he prayed, saying, "Oh my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done." It's a slight twist, but it's basically the exact same thing that he just prayed. Now, that brings up another point. Those same wizards of smart who try to tell you, you know, "Never pray, thy will be done," or whatever, also sometimes get out there and say, "Never pray for something more than once. It shows a lack of faith. Why do you need to pray for it a second time? You brought it before God, you know." That's garbage also, isn't it? Here we have Jesus praying, and before we're done, we're going to see him pray three times for this. The Apostle Paul, by the way, lest we just think, well, this is something special with Jesus and what was going on with the Father. The Apostle Paul, you remember when he tells us about his thorn in the flesh? This thing that was just causing him so much misery, a messenger of Satan buffeting him and all that. Now he prayed, "God, remove this from me." And Paul says he prayed three times for it to be. Now I'm saying three is some magic number, but you know, he prayed until he got the answer, just like Jesus got the answer here. It's not going to be removed from you, Paul. "My grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in your weakness." And Jesus, of course, likewise got the answer that, no, it's not possible. You must drink the cup. But there was multiple prayers until that became very clear to the one praying. So once more, don't let anyone say, "Oh, only pray once and then stop. Otherwise, it's a lack of faith." Because if someone thinks they have more faith than the Apostle Paul, then you don't want to be listening to that guy anyway, okay? All right. Well, verse 43 tells us that he came and he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. I mean, it is the middle of the night, you know, they're tired, no doubt. And so he left them, he went away again, prayed the third time, saying the same words. Notice Matthew doesn't include him a third time, but he does tell us that there was that third prayer. And then he came to his disciples, and he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." And unfortunately, we have to stop there because that, of time's sake, it's like watching a TV show and it's just getting real good. To be continued. You're like, oh. But the time is now. Now is the moment when decisions are going to be made. It is my firm belief that the real battle for our Lord Jesus Christ, we just read. And even though the physical suffering, and in addition to the tremendous physical suffering and torture, whatever it is that we cannot possibly relate to, that it was when the sins of the world were placed on Jesus at the cross. And he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? All of that that is about to come in the next several hours that we're going to be reading about over the next few weeks, throughout all of it, we see Jesus in control. We see him in charge, don't we? Because he knows the Father's will. There's no, again, debate about it. There's no more time for prayer because God's made it clear. At some point, we have to stop arguing with God. God makes his will clear in our lives, often clear through the scripture. Now, you may not get chapter and verse in terms of that very specific little detail in terms of something in your life, but you certainly have some pretty broad parameters about how you're to act with other people. And, you know, God's pretty clear that you desperately need this job, you know, so does that mean I can, like, lie on my resume and exaggerate my interviews and all this kind of thing? Like, no. Well, if you don't do that, you're never going to get the job. Everyone lies on their resume, you know. And you hear the world's advice, and you start thinking, maybe I should argue with God and listen to the world. And then you expect to be blessed. By the way, God, please give me. There's a time to stop arguing with God. God makes his will known. And so it is, again, my belief that we're going to see our Lord Jesus in complete control. Even when he's, you know, arrested and he's before these leaders like Pontius Pilate, we're going to see Jesus in control. Now, the disciples, on the other hand, are in a different place. Now is the time. The hour has come. My betrayer's here. Here we go. Here come the soldiers. They're arresting me right now. Here we go. How are the disciples going to respond? See, that's what you and I face as well in this life. And often it can come upon us quite swiftly, that moment of a decision, that moment of a response. I can't believe I just exploded on that person like that. Oh, I can't believe when someone asked me to do that, that I went ahead and said yes. I mean, how did I know? I thought we were just getting together for a game. I didn't know they were going to bring the bong out and start passing it around. But I didn't want to kind of fit in and, you know. Man, I can't believe I just blew up in front of that clerk, you know. Man, it was just a week ago I asked him to come to my church, Calvary Chapel. Hey, why don't you come on out? Here I am. Hey, I'm the pastor of Calvary Chapel. Come on out. But you see, it can happen like that. And we're there, and we respond, we're in the flesh, and we fall flat on our face, don't we? But it's not a foreordained reality. And this is where a lot of people are like, well, you know, because you're a sinner by nature, you're just going to sin, you know? Wait a minute, that's not the teaching of Scripture. But I guarantee you, if we're spending all our time sleeping instead of praying and instead of worshiping, instead of reading the Word, instead of seeking God and preparing ourselves. Preparing ourselves for the day. I don't know what temptations are going to come my way this day. I don't know what's going to hit me by surprise. But at some point, the hour is at hand. And that's our moment, isn't it? Now, you notice, I'm not talking about heaven or hell, like, oh, you better not blow it, man, or you're going to hell. You know, fast ticket over there. No, no, no. It has nothing to do with that. But I guarantee you that none of us wake up in the morning and say, I cannot wait to grieve the Spirit of God today. I cannot wait to just grieve my Savior who loves me and died for me and rose for me and never leaves me or forsakes me. I can't wait. I'm gonna think of something really good. We don't start the day like that. But at the same time, if we don't start the day by thinking, Lord, I need you. I need thee every hour. I don't know what awaits me, but I want to walk in the Spirit today. I want your will to be done. Help me, Lord, in those moments. If I have to make a response, may it be the godly response that honors you and gives glory to your name. Help me to just take a step back and not feel like I owe everyone an answer on the spot or, you know, and just say, well, you know, I need to pray about that before I make a mistake. I want to know what God's will is for this. We need an answer right now. Well, then I guess I'm not the guy. To prepare ourselves. And the Bible talks about putting on the whole armor of God and so forth. Because, you know, you want to be an Olympic athlete, you're not going to just show up on the opening ceremonies, right? When's my race? On Tuesday? I'll be there. And, you know, I try to be funny, but as Christians, it seems like so often a lot of people, that's how they're just living their life. Just kind of like, well, you know, whenever the race starts, I'll be there. Or you think you're going to do well? Well, that's a different thing. But we're all sinners. We sin every time. That's not how I want to live my life. I want to bring glory and honor to the Savior. I know there's nothing. Again, not my will. Your will be done, Father. As Jesus said, abide in me. Apart from me, you can't do a thing. Well, we would all amen that. But we need to abide in Jesus Christ. And again, it has nothing to do with the issue of salvation. It has to do with bearing fruit in our lives. Salvation's a free gift. He did all the work. Not only do you not earn it, you don't work to keep it. You receive it. But having received the Lord Jesus Christ, now let's go walk in Him. Live our lives. And really, isn't that what the New Testament epistles spend an awful lot of time talking about? Our salvation is explained, yes, but then chapter after chapter, book after book, how as Christians are we to live our lives here until the day that God calls us home, whenever that day might be. We're not just waiting out the clock here, you know, take a number and one of these days you'll die and go to heaven. We're part of the body of Christ. We're each one members. We've got certain gifts, certain things that, and God will use us for His purposes and His glory. But again, to be used, we have some responsibility on our end to make ourselves usable, if I can use that term. The hour is at hand. Next week we'll see how the disciples handle this hour of temptation versus how our Lord handles it. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for this time in your word. And we do pray your blessing upon our lives as we go forth now. We do want to bring glory to you, Lord. Any positive, good act of service or love that we might accomplish, may we always be quick to give you the credit, to point people to you. And so, Lord, thank you again for this time, these incredible lessons that are revealed to us in the words of the Scriptures here. And bless as we dismiss now in Jesus' name. Amen.